Thinking Big in Small Places. You enjoyed this series so far? Amen. We're going to look at our foundational text here, 2 Corinthians. It's out of the Message Bible, so we're going to put it on the screens. Maybe? There we go. 2 Corinthians 6. It says, "Dear, dear Corinthians." Could we say, "Dear, dear El Pasoans"? "I can't tell you how much I long for you to enter this wide open, spacious life. We didn't fence you in." The smallness you feel comes from where? From where? Did he blame that on God? Did he even blame it on the devil? No. The smallness you feel comes from within you. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. I'm speaking as plainly as I can and with great affection. Open up your lives, Abundant Living Faith Center. Live openly, El Paso. Live expansively, Abundant Living. We didn't fence you in. God's got this wide open, spacious life for you. Open up your lives, 10:30 service. Tear the fence down. Walk out into the big life God has for you. How many of you know God is big? Amen. Amen. And how many of you believe that God has a big life for you? Amen. How many of you truly do believe that in every moment of your life, God is on your side? And we know from Jeremiah 29:11 that he has great plans for our lives, plans to bring us a hope and a future. So I wonder today, have we really accepted that God has a big life for us? How do you view your life? What vision do you have for your present and your future? Do you see it the way God sees it, in a wide open, spacious life, living openly and expansively, going from glory to glory, faith to faith, victory to victory, promise to promise? Do you see it the way God sees it, or do you see yourself fenced in, living small, frustrated, disappointed? How do you view yourself as a husband or wife, father or mother? As friend, as brother or sister, how do you see yourself as employer or employee? How do you see yourself as a child of God? What vision do you have for your life? See, I believe that God has great plans for each and every one of us. And we've looked at the process that God takes us through. Right? Last week we saw that we need to trust the process, that God is the God of small beginnings. And he told us not to despise those small beginnings. Yeah, he's the God of small beginnings, but he's also the God who brings increase to the beginning. Amen? Though your beginning was small, your latter day will greatly increase, he says. That word greatly means abundantly. And then we saw God's key to promotion, which is the choice of faithfulness. Where Jesus told the men in the parable of the talents, "Though you have been faithful over little, over small, I will make you ruler over much." I'll make your life big. Our choice of being faithful is truly God's key to bringing promotion into our lives. So today we're going to conclude this series. Today we are going to move from thinking big in small places. Today we're going to tear the fence down and we're going to start stepping out into the big living. Amen? We're going to tear it down. And Paul said, though, that smallness you feel comes from within you. And boy, isn't that the truth sometimes, huh? It's amazing how often in life we are our own worst enemy. We live foolishly. We make bad decisions. Oh my goodness. We flat out disobey God. Right? A lot of times we don't deal with our insecurities, our doubts, and our fears, and then we project those insecurities out into our lives. And those insecurities become problems that we have to deal with. As the Bible said, they become the mountains in our lives, Mark 11, right? We build the mountain, and then the Bible says that you have to speak to the mountain by faith and tell the mountain to be removed, so then we have to fight the fight of faith against ourselves. It's amazing, right? I mean, we will, with our own choices and behaviors, we'll go out, dig the pothole, and then run over the pothole, then get mad at God that there was a pothole. And God's up there like, what? I didn't make the pothole? Start living smarter. You know what else is amazing, though? On the flip side, we can also be our greatest allies. We really can. We change our thinking, change our behavior, change our believing, change how we view life, and we can become our greatest ally. And we can align ourselves with Jesus Christ. And instead of digging the pothole and running over the pothole, we will have smooth sailing over a clear path that God has created for us. Amen? See, I believe that one of the most underrated aspects of humanity is the power of our thinking and the determination of our wills. It is amazing what humanity can accomplish when we just decide we're going to accomplish it. When we just determine this is who I'm going to be, it's amazing how that can just change your life. When you just decide, I'm not going to do that anymore. No. No. This is not who we're going to be. It's amazing what we can accomplish. It's amazing what communities and churches can accomplish when we decide this is what we're going to do. Amen? Why is that? It's because of the power of thinking. Proverbs says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And then he tells us in Proverbs 4, above all else, guard your heart, because out of it flows the issues of your life. So your thinking becomes the issue of your heart, or plainly put, it becomes your believing. And your believing produces the results that you will deal with in your life. So wherever your thinking is leads to your believing. Whatever your believing is leads to the consequences of your life. So what's your thinking? Amen? Are you your own worst enemy, or are you your best friend? Are you fencing yourself in, or are you tearing the fence down? Do you see yourself as an overcomer through Jesus Christ, or are you putting the fence down? Do you see yourself as a grasshopper like the nation of Israel, or do you see yourself as powerful and mighty like Joshua and Caleb? Amen? So today we tear the fence down. Listen, it's one thing to think big in small places. It's quite another thing to start living big. Amen? But God has laid it out for us. He shows us how to do it, so let's go do it. How many of you want everything God has for you? Amen? Amen? All right. Number one, Philippians 3, verse 12 through 16, out of the Message Bible again. I mean, just look at the words here. Paul speaking, I'm not saying that I have this all together. How many of you don't have it all together all the time? So if the Apostle Paul didn't have it all together, does that mean that we can probably do some stuff and not have it all together also? Thank God, right? I mean, none of us are perfect. I mean, I don't have it all figured out all the time. Neither do you, though. Put the scripture back up. Not saying I have it all together, that I have it made, but I'm on my way. Tearing the fence down, reaching out for who? For Christ, who has so wondrously reached out for me. Friends, don't get me wrong. By no means do I count myself an expert in all of this. So Paul says you don't even have to be an expert to step out into faith and head towards what God is giving you. You don't have to have it all figured out. What you need to do is look at Jesus. What did he say? I don't have it all figured out. I don't have it made, but I look to Jesus. Amen? Put the scripture back up. By no means do I count myself an expert in all of this, but I've got my eye on the goal. where God is beckoning us onward to Jesus. I'm off and running and I'm not turning back. Next one. So let's keep focused on that goal. Those of us who want everything God has for us, and that's us, right? 10:30 service? If any of you have something else in mind, something less than total commitment, God will clear your blurred vision. You'll see it yet. Now that we're on the right track, let's stay on it. Look what it says. Let's keep focused on the goal. Let's keep focused on the goal and have nothing less than total commitment. My family, the first thing that faces us when we are gonna tear the fence down and stop living fenced in and start heading toward the big life that God has for us is a decision about who we are and what our future is going to look like. And that decision is this, that you will do whatever it takes to get where God wants you to go. That you will determine in your mind, in your heart, in your soul, and in your spirit, that you will do what it takes, whatever it takes. I'll fight, I'll scratch, I'll claw, I'll persevere. If I fall, I'm gonna get back up. If I fail, I'm gonna learn and go forward. I will do whatever it takes. I'll go where I need to go. I'll hear what I need to hear. I'll be with who I need to be with. But no matter what, like Paul, I see the goal. I see it. It's in front of me. I look to Jesus. I may not have it all figured out. I don't have it made yet, but I'm gonna go. I'm not staying fenced in here. I'm not living in this small life. God says I can have a big life. I want that wide open, spacious life. I wanna live openly. I wanna live expansively. I wanna walk into the promised land where the land flows with milk and honey. I'm not going back into the wilderness like the nation of Israel. No, I'm gonna do whatever it takes. I will fight, I will go forward, I will work, I will determine, but whatever it takes, you're not getting me off of this path. I see the goal and I'm going towards the goal. Whatever it takes. See, I've found, my family, so often in life, the most successful people are simply the ones who are the most determined and focused. They're just the most determined. And when challenge rises, when obstacles rise, when they're in a fight, they just don't give up. They just outlast it. And they do whatever it takes. You know, this Paul that wrote about this, this is the same Paul that wrote about being shipwrecked, being beaten more times than he could count, being stoned. I mean, what? Being left out in the sea, being whipped, having his friends betray him, feeling lost. The list goes on and on. I mean, it's an intense list. And then he says, but I press on toward the goal. You know, my family, listen, success isn't always easy. It's not always easy. It's not always simple. It's not even always convenient. There's sacrifice. There's fight. There's determination. But are you gonna get where God wants you to go, or are you gonna quit and give up? Who are we gonna be? Are we gonna fight the fight of faith and see victory, or are we just gonna sit down, fence ourselves in, and be our own worst enemy? Sit down in our comfort zone. Oh, it's nice here. No, no, I don't want a comfort zone. I want God's promises. Amen? My goodness. No matter what happens, they will not waver. I wrote down a couple ideas. The mentality of the do whatever it takes person. Write these down. This person says, I will do more than I'm paid to do. I'll do more than I'm paid to do. You wanna get promoted at work? Go do more than you're paid to do. You go be the above and beyond guy. You know, Jesus said, if a man compels you to walk a mile, walk two. Go above and beyond. You'll get that promotion. I'll try harder than I want to try. You got a little more inside you? Number three, I'll cut out what I need to cut out. You know, maybe your finances will get in order if you started consuming less. We all have stuff we could cut out. I'll give more than I have to. The world of the generous gets what? Bigger and bigger. We want to go from small thinking to big living, right? So I give more than I have to give. I'll help more than I need to. I'll help more than I need to. I wrote down next to that, I'll sacrifice whatever it takes for the good of my family. Listen, we all know in our households, every week my wife's gonna ask me to help her with the same thing. Well, why not quit making her ask you to help and you just start helping? Amen. Amen? And then do a little more beyond that. I tell you, a great way to have an incredible marriage, let that spouse of yours go to bed every night thinking, this person next to me will sacrifice and do whatever it takes for the good of our household. You want to have a good marriage? You want your spouse to appreciate you? Let them go to bed every night thinking, that person next to me will do whatever it takes for our household, for me, for my children. They will do whatever it takes. They will sacrifice whatever. They will help whatever and whenever for the good of our family. My God, you'll have a good marriage. Number six, waste less time. Boy, are we good at that or what? Number seven, spend more time with God. Well, I never hear the voice of God. Well, do you ever stop and try to listen? Well, I come to church. Okay, that's an hour and a half out of 7 days of the week. Do you spend time in prayer? Do you read his word? You want to hear the voice of God? Open the Bible. He'll speak to you. He will jump out at you. He'll give you more than you were ready for. You'll be like, whoa, Lord, slow down. How many of you are going to do whatever it takes? Number two, Acts 13, verse 40 through 41. Wrong one. I'll read it. It says, watch out, cynics. You guys, there it is. Watch out, cynics. Look hard. Watch your world fall to pieces. I'm doing something right before your eyes that you won't even believe, even though it's staring you in the face. Watch out, cynics. You know, I have found that the moment you step out in faith, the moment you step out, the enemy will try to flood your life with every reason why you shouldn't be doing it. He'll try to get you to look at everything you're not. All the reasons why. He'll even use your friends and family. You want to know why? Because the truth is, some of your friends and some of your family actually don't want your life to get better. See, you living a defeated life justifies their living a defeated life. You living small makes them feel better about their small life. But you know what? Just because they've accepted it doesn't mean you have to accept it. Just because they've accepted defeat and failure doesn't mean you have to accept it. Well, all our families get divorced. You don't have to get a divorce. Why don't you be the first one to prove them wrong? Well, nobody in our family's gone to school. Why don't you be the first one to go get a degree? Nobody in my wife's family had gotten a degree. She went to law school. I was like, 4 years wasn't enough for you, girl? I just went to school because he made me go to school. Like, God, can I just have a job? I was just going to school to come back and work here. Why couldn't I just come work here? It's amazing how the enemy will just flood your life with negativity, with cynicism, with pessimism. But look what happens. If you read the scripture backwards, you see what he's trying to do. It says that you won't believe it even though it's staring you in the face. And that's exactly what cynicism does, huh? It clouds your vision. You quit seeing life with the right perspective. You quit seeing it with hope, with faith, with expectation. You quit seeing it through the eyes of what Jesus said, and you start seeing it through the mind of cynicism, of negativity. You quit focusing on everything you are, and you look at your life through everything you're not. You allow what is within you, as Paul said, to become your worst enemy, the negativity. It clouds your vision. Look at the definition of cynicism, and it says that it is bitterly or sneeringly distrustful or pessimistic. You ever met that angry negative person? Like they're so negative, they're mad that you're not as negative as they are. And you're like, dude, like, chill, bro. They're like angry about it, right? Here's the voice of cynicism. You saw it in the Bible with Jesus. Oh, nothing good could ever come out of Nazareth. Really? Nothing good except for the Savior of all humanity. Right? But you, hey, let's just bring that into real life talk. Right here. You ever heard that about El Paso? Oh, nothing good ever comes out of El Paso. I mean, if you want to get a good job, you better go where the action's at. You better move to Austin or Houston. I mean, nobody can make any money in El Paso. Really? We went to State Line after dinner last night. 50-minute wait. But nobody got no money. Come on, man. Jeez. All the mega churches care about is your money. So let me get this straight. Jesus builds his church. Jesus said not to covet money, but then Jesus is blessing the churches and growing the churches that only care about money? See, no, that's where 2 + 2 = 5. It don't equal 5, man, it equals 4. But cynicism clouds your vision. And then it comes to steal your believing. To steal it from you. And where you used to have a positive expectation, you used to have faith, now you don't. You used to have hope, and that cynicism comes to take it. So that you'll give up on life, you'll give up on your dreams, you'll just fence yourself back in. You started to tear the fence down, but then you went, oh, no, you know, yeah, I mean, I don't have it all figured out. So I'll just stay here. Or like the nation of Israel, there's giants in the land? Oh, man. What do you mean the walls are fortified, guys? Oh, sounds better to just go back out into the wilderness. Yeah, that sounded fun. See, but the enemy uses negativity and cynicism to rob us of our hope. Ultimately, what he's getting to is to rob you of your faith. See, my family, the Bible says that hope is the anchor of your soul, but truly hope is the heartbeat of your faith. And what did it say? It says that you won't believe, and then it says, and watch your world fall to pieces. See, my family, the Bible says that this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. In the Message Bible, it says that faith is the overcoming power that brings the enemy and the world to its knees. But if you give up hope, your faith then has nothing to do, because faith is the substance of things hoped for. So the enemy rushes you with cynicism when you step out to try to get you to accept it, to rob you of your hope, to steal your faith from you, because where there is no faith, there is no victory. And guess what? Your life falls to pieces. So we have to guard ourselves against cynicism. Amen? Amen. You glad you came to church so far? Amen. Acts 16, verse 6 through 8. Here's Paul traveling. Says they went to that place. And then on through the region of Galatia, their plan was to turn west. But the Holy Spirit blocked that route. So they went to Mysia. Did you know that he traveled through Las Cruces? Isn't that amazing? I wonder if he went to Chico's. So they went to Mysia and tried to go north to another place, but the Spirit of Jesus wouldn't let them go there either. You know, there's two plans in the world. There's our plans and there's God's plans. So number one, when we're tearing the fence down, we decide we're gonna do whatever it takes. Number two, we reject cynicism. The question is, in doing whatever it takes, are we gonna accept God's plan or are we more determined to live on our plan? See, I've found so often that Christians will obey God's plan if God's plan fits within their plan. If it doesn't fit within their plan, oh, well, I'm just not sure that was the voice of the Lord. No, we don't like that. See, we like what's convenient for us. We want easy Christianity. See, Paul had plans, and the Holy Spirit blocked it. And you know, the truth is that sometimes we see a plan, and it looks good. But God's plans are greater. Sometimes we want to rush God. We're in a hurry to get where we want to go. I knew a friend of mine that got passed up for a promotion, got all discouraged, deserved the promotion. Come to find out in that department there was corruption. And the whole department ended up getting shut down. 2 years later, he got promoted to rebuild the department. But he trusted God. I mean, it wasn't fun during the 2 years. I think God was protecting him from something. I do. I believe with all my heart he was protecting him because everybody got cleared out. You know what I'm saying? See, God's ways are not always our ways. God's plans are not always our plans. God's timing isn't always our timing. But my family, we have to trust and believe that God's ways are better than our ways. God's plans are better than our plans. And his timing, listen to me, God's timing is always the right timing. And look at what happened with Paul in verse 9 and 10. It said, that night Paul had a dream. A Macedonian stood on the far shore across the sea and said, come to Macedonia and help us. The dream gave Paul his map. So because he obeyed, God then gave him his direction. We went to work at once, getting things ready. All the pieces had come together. My family, here's the reality. It is our job to trust and obey God's plan. It is God's plan to then do what he does best and bring the pieces together. Amen. But are we going to trust it or not? Amen. Number four, Acts 13, 4 through 5. Now, this is just at the beginning of Paul's ministry. It even literally still calls him Saul. So he is going from little to big, stepping out, tearing the fence down, right? And look what it says. Sent off on their new assignment by the Holy Spirit, Barnabas and Saul went down to Seleucia and caught a ship for Cyprus. The first thing they did when they put in at Salami was preach God's word in the Jewish meeting places. They had John there to help them out. Next slide. They traveled the length of the island and at Paphos came upon a Jewish wizard who had worked himself into the confidence of the governor, Sergius Paulus, an intelligent man who was not easily taken by charlatans. The wizard's name was Bar-Jesus. Wow. He was as crooked as a corkscrew. The governor invited Barnabas and Saul in, wanting to hear God's word firsthand from them. But Dr. Know-It-All, you ever known any Dr. Know-It-Alls? Stirred up a ruckus. And that is exactly what the enemy will try to do, my family. Leave that up there for a minute. Isn't that exactly what the enemy will try to do? Just stir up a ruckus in front of you? You step out in faith and all of a sudden. But you know what The enemy tries to make himself look like a tornado, but all he is one of those little sand things in your backyard. He's a vapor, my family. The devil has no control over you. He has no power over you. He cannot even affect you if you will determine in your heart that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. No power over you. No power, no place. He was defeated at the very moment that Jesus rose from the grave. The devil's power over you was defeated. It was robbed. It was taken. He has no place in your life if you will give him no place. All he can do is try to stir up a ruckus and make you think and try to intimidate you, try to get you to look away, try to scare you back into your fence. Oh, this is too big for me. No, this is too hard. I don't have it all together. No, you don't understand what I've done. I'm not worthy of that. No, I'm not good enough. He'll just try to stir up a ruckus. Stir up a ruckus. Look what Paul did. Put it back up. But Paul, Saul, full of the Holy Spirit and looking him straight in the eye. Looking him straight in the eye, says, "You bag of wind, you devil. Why you stay up nights inventing schemes to cheat people out of God?" And that's just what he's trying to do. He's just trying to cheat you, to trick you out of what God has for you. But now you've come up against God himself, and your game is up, devil. You're going to go blind. And he was plunged immediately into a shadowy mist. Oh my gosh. You know, the reality is, my family, is Satan just doesn't want you to occupy more space. See, the more space you occupy, the less he occupies. Because where you and the power of God are, he cannot be. So the moment you tear that fence down and you step out in faith, oh, he'll just try to stir up a little ruckus, but you don't worry about that. You don't worry about that. You do like Paul, and you just stare it down. You stare it down. Because you've already determined you'll do whatever it takes. You're going to trust in God's timing. You've got your eye on the goal. You see the promise. You see the land that flows with milk and honey. Oh, there might be giants in the land. Oh, those walls might be fortified. It might be tough, but I'm going to stare it down. And I'm going to get where God wants me to go. I'm going to get there. But see, sometimes you just have to determine, I'm going to fight the fight of faith. I'm going to fight. I'm going to do whatever it takes. And the enemy will try to rush your mind. Oh, you're not strong enough. Oh, you just stare that enemy down and you remind him that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. No, but I'm a loser, Jared. I'm a loser. No, you're not. The Bible says you are a winner. You are not a doubter. You are not a loser. You're a winner. You're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, that everything you set your hand to do can prosper through Jesus Christ. Oh, but Jared, you don't understand what I've done. There's no way that I could be forgiven. No, you just look at him and say, Jesus loves me unconditionally. And you stare that regret. You stare that shame. You stare that guilt down and you tell him, I'm a born-again child of the Most High God, accepted into his family. Oh, but where's the resource going to come from? Where's it going to come from? And you stare that devil down, that ruckus down, and you say, all my needs are met according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But what am I going to do, Jared? What am I going to do? I'm not strong enough. No, you are mighty through Jesus Christ. And you stare that devil down and say, I am more than a conqueror, because Jesus lives on the inside of me. But Jared, I don't have all the answers, and sometimes I feel weak, and I don't have it all together. What am I going to do? And you stare that doubt, that cynicism, and that negativity down, and you remind them what the Bible says, and you declare that God's grace is sufficient for you in every situation, and you remind yourself that when you are weak, God's power is perfected on the inside of you. My family, I can't tell you what that scripture means to me. I can't tell you how many times I've stepped out of my fence and I've stood there with doubt, with fear, with confusion, and I've just said, God, your grace, it better be sufficient. Your word says it is, so it better. And I'm telling you, he's met me every step of the way. Every step. But are you going to tear the fence down? What did Paul say? We didn't fence you in. Live openly, abundant living. Walk out into that wide open, spacious life. See, I want everything God has for me. I want everything God has for our church. I believe with all my heart that this is a small beginning in our church. I declare it. I believe it. This, again, is a small beginning. The best is yet to come. And I believe it for you and your family. Amen. Are you glad you came to church today? Stand to your feet. Lift your hands towards heaven. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we want all that you have. All your promises be yes and amen in our lives, in our future, in our families. In Jesus' name, we vow right here, right now, Lord, we will do whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. We'll fight whatever fight. We will scratch. We will claw. We will persevere. We will persist. We'll cut out what we need to cut out. We'll bring in what we need to bring in, Lord. We'll do whatever it takes. We're going to tear the fence down, Lord. When that cynicism comes, we're walking right through it. Right through it, Lord. We reject all of that. We trust in your plan. Lead us and guide us, Father. Pour out your wisdom onto our lives liberally, as Paul said. Show us the path. And Lord, we declare that we will not take our eyes off the goal. And we will go forward to whatever you have for us. And we will enjoy all of it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Can you just give God a great shout of praise for his word? God bless you. Thank you for being here today.